So today I'll talk about in the study of Riemannian geometry, broadly one can divide it into three phases. One is at the level of the metric itself, which is what whatever we could do last time we did that. Next thing is an object which involves the first derivatives of the metric, which is the connection. And then third stage is something involving second derivatives of the metric, which is curvature. So I'll come to the connection part now. For us, last time I ended on the theme of locally length minimizing curves. But it was not apparent that such things exist at all. So now the idea is to formulate the locally length minimizing condition in terms of an ordinary differential equation, which one can always solve, and at least we know that for short time such curves will exist. Once we are able to recast that condition in terms of an ODE. And that's one of the ways that this notion of connection pops up. So this the concept of a connection has become very fundamental in modern differential geometry in various forms, and there are conceptually very different looking definitions of connections on principal bundles, and the what is called the Erasmann connection, which I'll talk about now, and well, connection given purely locally, which is what physicists thought about in the early part of the 20th century in terms of some Christoffel symbols and so on. But for us, in our setting, let me just define a general connection first. A connection is a So, no, this is not the Euler characteristic of M. This is the vector space, R vector space of smooth vector fields. Connection is a bilinear map satisfying so this will denote by xy maps to nabla xy satisfying if I multiply the vector field by a smooth function, so these two, it's certainly not going to be a symmetric bilinear form. So they have very different roles. One is supposed to think of this as differentiating the vector field y along the direction x. So the object being differentiated is this one. And this is the sort of the direction in which you are differentiating. So if you multiply this vector field by a function, you'll get another smooth vector field. And the point is that this equation is supposed to hold. And the second one is a version of Leibniz rule, if I multiply this by a function, well, so this is supposed to be like a product, basically. Essentially, this is a product. So I differentiate this, this first, keeping this as it is, then do it the other way. So then the second term will be differentiating this, keeping this as it is. So differentiating this along x, that is just differentiating a function along a vector field is the directional derivative. So this is usually, a version of Leibniz rule in this setting. This way of defining a connection is somewhat, I mean, it's from a geometric point of view, it's not entirely satisfactory. After all, we have just stated some purely formal looking conditions without any, it's not clear how, what role this has to play in the geometric setting. Fortunately, one can recast this in far more sort of a more geometric way, but I won't have time to do that. Let's just take it for this as the definition. This is the standard definition. It's easy to work with. This that's the only advantage of this. But in fact, so this is a what is called this. If I just had this, this would be called an affine connection. I demand, but when I say the Riemannian connection, I can impose two more conditions. If I take two vector fields y and z and form the this, then this becomes a function. So this quantity here is actually the function p maps to evaluation of the inner product. So if I differentiate this function, take the directional derivative, I'm supposed to again, it's a version of Leibniz rule. So I can first do this, take the derivative of this, keeping this as it is, and then. So this is called compatibility with the metric. Metric compatible. Finally, we have the most somewhat mysterious looking condition, which is hard to explain. Unless you completely recast this. So it is this condition. What happens if I interchange x and y? Del x, nabla xy minus nabla yx. We demand that this is just the Lie bracket of xy. If a connection satisfies this, it's said to be torsion-free. So what the meaning of this is, well, is a different story, but let's just say that the good thing is that the moment you start have a Riemannian metric, there exists a unique connection which satisfies all four properties. So we can regard it as coming for free. If this the meaning of this is not clear, we can just think of it as we have a connection which does satisfy which does satisfy this, and this will be useful. In some sense, yeah. Yeah, as Arvinda pointed out, anyway, the Lie bracket is certainly has nothing to do with the metric. It's just the moment you have a smooth structure, you have that. While this side apparently has to do with the connection. So it seems like a somewhat strong condition to hold that combination should somehow be independent of the connection itself. Now, as I said, so this is called the Riemannian or Levi-Civita connection. I won't do the proof of this. It looks very impressive when I write it like this, but actually the proof is fairly straightforward. You just essentially you start with this equation and you vary this x, y, z. Write down three such equations. Then you try to solve for some quantity like this, the inner product of nabla x, y, z. If you know, then you'll get an equation for nabla proof. Essentially, you express the inner product of nabla x, y, z after permuting this x, y, z, writing down three equations, subtracting one from the other, and then using this, what you end up is that you can express this quantity solely in terms of the metric and Lie brackets and so on. Essentially, nabla will not occur on this side. So, in effect, you have what we know is that I know the inner product of nabla xy with every z. So that gives me nabla xy. That's all. So the right-hand stuff will involve only g and Lie brackets and so on. But there won't be any nabla. So it's a purely formal algebraic thing. That's all. And this, once I write it like this, it will show both existence and uniqueness. I can define nabla xy by this equation, whatever I have here. On the other hand, if I had one such thing, it has to be prescribed by this. It has to be unique. Everything, all right, that does it. So in short, it's just a purely algebraic thing. Now, as I said, we are going to use connection in at least two different ways. One is, we are going to define curvature using this. But before that, we are going to define geodesics using this. To define geodesics, I need to make this following observation. If I have two vector fields, nabla xy, and suppose I'll get another vector field like this, and I want to see the tangent vector at a point P, the value of the vector field at a point. The observation is that this depends only on x at p and the values of y along any curve sigma with So what I'm saying is that strictly speaking, these need to be vector fields. In other words, they have to be defined on open, at least open subsets of the manifold. But though the first two defining conditions of the connection, you can check that that will force that quantity. If I want to see what it is here, all I have to know is xp. I don't even have to know, I just have to know a single vector, xp, and I have to know y along any curve, sigma. I don't have to know y in an open neighborhood in particular. And it can, this curve can be any curve. The only restriction is, of course, that that curve should start in the direction of xp. That follows from 1. Yeah, with this observation in hand, so now let me define a geodesic. Now, yeah, it's in order for this expression to even make sense, I had to make that observation. And these are not vector fields. So gamma is a curve in the manifold. So gamma dot is just the tangent vector to gamma, the curve gamma at gamma t. So this gamma dot t is a bunch of vectors which are defined only on the curve, but that suffices to calculate this from what I said there. And gamma is a curve which, of course, at every point, it passes through gamma t in the in this direction. So gamma serves the role as a role of sigma. And so this one way of thinking of this is as an acceleration vector. In fact, if you do it in Euclidean space, you will get precisely gamma double dot t. You don't get anything else. So this is the definition of a geodesic. Now, the main point is that yeah, so how did this come about? Well, that I won't go, I won't have time to get into this, but basically, so this equation arises from the First variation formula. For length. So remember, we were interested in finding length minimizing curves, and so what one can do is one can look at all curves. You fix two points in the Riemannian manifold, look at the set of all curves connecting these two points. Or let's say piecewise C1 curves connecting these two points. If you, the set of all such curves is not quite a manifold, it's an infinite dimensional manifold in some sense. Nevertheless, it is some set, and on that set one has a function the length function. So every time you have a curve, you just take the length of that curve. So, and in some sense, one can say so if this function were to be a smooth function on this infinite dimensional manifold of curves, then it would be natural to look for critical points, say minima or local minima, local maxima of this. Actually, what we are interested in are local minima, length minimizing curves. So the first step, even before finding minima or maxima, is just to locate critical points of this function on the space of curves. So L is a map from, it's denoted by omega PQ, the path space. So on this, and we want to find critical points of this. Now, since this omega PQ is infinite dimensional, we can't really talk about derivative and so on in the usual sense. It becomes a bit messy. However, it's easy to say, at least talk about critical points. When is something a critical point? Well, if I take a curve here, if this were an actual manifold, and suppose I take a curve inside this space, and suppose this point were to be a critical point. No, P is not a good thing. Alpha. If this is a critical point, then it would be the case that this should be zero. Essentially, you restrict the function to the curve, then it becomes a function of one variable. If something is a critical point, then the derivative would be zero. Yeah, this is a function to R. So along every direction, the derivative should be zero. To say something is a critical point, this curve, this should hold for every curve sigma. If you have a function on a manifold, and that function from the manifold to real numbers, and something is a critical point. If you start at the critical point in any direction, and if you restrict the function to such a curve, you get a function of one variable, and then this equation should hold. Yeah, that's it. So, but notice that what one had to do here was take a curve inside the space. This already is the set of curves. But inside that, we are taking a curve. So in effect, what we are doing is we are taking a one parameter family of curves, which start at our given curve. So let's say this curve is alpha. And then I'm varying this by a bunch of curves. I would be calculating the length of each one of those, and then putting this equal to zero. Now, a curve of curves would amount to just a map of this sigma that I'm talking about here is a map from an interval into omega PQ. This is actually amounts to having a two-parameter family of curves inside the manifold. a one parameter family, a path inside this is just a two parameter family of curves inside M. That's all. So the starting object in the study of variation formulas is something like this. One starts with this, a two parameter family of curves. Then one writes down the formula for the length. Then goes ahead, does the differentiation. And of course, see the differentiation, remember the length of a curve involved some expression like this. Now, here one has to be a bit, anyway, let me not go into too much detail, but essentially you will be using this equation. At some point, you'll end up using that equation because you'll be differentiating this quantity, the d by dt, that t is not the same as this t. I should be a bit careful. The t I've written there is somewhat different. So you'll be differentiating this. One has to use the metric compatibility and then so on and so forth. Anyway, you look at the, please have a look at the text. The you end up using all the defining properties of the connection. And then finally, the point is, this is supposed to hold for every path which starts at alpha. Maybe I should call this gamma. Gamma is, yeah. So this should hold for every path starting at gamma. From that, essentially, one can derive this equation. This is the equation that gamma has to. So in physics terminology, this is the Hamiltonian function, and that would be the Euler-Lagrange equation, or not physics terms, variational calculus. You have a functional, and then you have the Euler-Lagrange equations. That's what this is. The variation is chosen so that, first of all, all the curves have to start and end here. That's the only restriction. But finally, actually, one has to choose a specific variation to get this equation. At the end, you have to choose a specific variation and get this. Constant speed, I just mean that the norm of the velocity is constant. Norm gamma prime t is constant. That can always be achieved for any curve. Just a reparametrization. Any curve can be made to have constant speed. So locally, so the main point is that a smooth curve is a geodesic if and only if it's a locally length minimizing curve with constant speed. In fact, this locally, I don't even have to add this smooth. The moment it's locally length minimizing, one can check that it has to be automatically smooth. That piecewise condition of this kind of picture cannot be locally length minimizing, because the problem is created here. There'll be, I mean, this part cannot be a minimizing curve. I can take a shortcut. So locally length minimizing will force smoothness. So this is redundant if I am adding this here. Now, the proof essentially is just that first variation formula. The usual way it goes is slightly different, but actually first variation formula, and one can do it in a different way. Anyway, I'm not telling you the proof, but there is a way of doing it using the first variation formula, which has to do with the first derivative of length. One can, once one has a critical point of this length function, then it's natural to ask if it's a local max or a local min. So in other words, look at the second derivative of the length function, something like the Hessian. And in fact, there is a formula for that as well. While the first variation formula involves only the connection, the Hessian of this will involve the curvature of the metric, which I'm about to define next. So at this stage, I can't even tell you what the second variation formula is. But for those who know, it might be an interesting exercise to use these two to prove this. The normally, the way this is proved is not like this. One doesn't use the second variation formula. One takes a different route. But it might be a fun exercise to try to combine this and get this. The point is, which part? Yeah, locally. Yeah, right. If a curve is a geodesic, then it is locally length minimizing. That is the part which requires a bit of thought. From all that I've explained, if a curve is a geodesic, it's a critical point of the length function, which still doesn't say it's locally length minimizing. That's the part which has to be checked. Now, how do we actually find geodesics in concrete Riemannian manifolds? There are many ways of geometrically, sometimes the presence of isometries help, but a brute force method of doing this is just to use local charts. So let's just see what this that geodesic equation in local coordinates, it looks like. So when I say coordinate chart, unlike before, I don't mean open set in the manifold, which is diffeomorphic to an open set in Rn. I've transferred, let me just assume that I've transferred all the data from the manifold, from the open set in the manifold to an open set in Rn. So I'll be just working in Rn now. In particular, this curve itself will be just given by, so this curve is a gamma would be a map from an interval into U. So it'll have n components. So then this equation is equivalent to d squared gamma by dt squared plus capital gamma t, and the summation is over ing. So you get n second order nonlinear equations, ODEs, from this one. Now, what are these gamma I, j, k that I have written here? These are the so-called Christoffel symbols. Associated to the connection. I mean, it's not anything mysterious. It's just that you evaluate the connection on the coordinate vector fields and express it in terms of the coordinate vector fields again. Pick out the coefficient functions. Those are the Christoffel symbols. That's all. The point is that they have nothing to do with the curve as such. The moment you fix the coordinate chart, we have these functions. Of course, the metric and the Riemannian connection have been fixed. So these are fixed functions. And I'm evaluating it here. Okay, fine. Now, in fact, this Christoffel symbols, one can explicitly express in terms of the metric and its for the metric Gij and its derivatives. From that, when I talked about uniqueness of existence and uniqueness of the connection, that same formula will enable you to find out what exactly these things are. And so in the theory, the moment one has a metric and a coordinate chart, one can find out this. Plug it in here and solve this ODE system. Of course, in practice, it might be horrendously complicated. But theoretically, we know that any such system will have a unique solution, existence and uniqueness. Once we prescribe the initial data, unique solution with prescribed initial data.
Oh, how much time do I have?
Okay. Initial data, gamma 0 equals P, gamma prime 0 equals V. And, oh, of course, the main point is that this will be defined. We don't know how large the interval on the size of the interval on which it's defined. I did all that stuff just to get the ODE. Once I have the solution, of course, I'll go back to the manifold. So this gamma I regard as being in the manifold. So before I go further, so let me just write down the geodesics in some examples of geodesics. The trivial example is in the case of in the Euclidean space, this gamma ijk, these functions turn out to be identically zero. So all you're left with is the equation that the second order derivatives of all the component functions vanish. So each one of them is an affine linear expression, each of these gamma is. And you put them together and the whole thing is a straight line. So, every geodesic is a line. This is the most trivial one. Then, in for this workshop, this hyperbolic space is the more interesting one. So, here I'm looking at the upper half space model. So the claim is that by the boundary, I mean this the space Xn equals 0. So every geodesic is a portion of a straight line which meets the boundary orthogonally, or a circle which meets the boundary orthogonally. So now, actually, in this case, this is one case where this will work fine. Though this is not the most elegant way to do it, the formula for the metric is so simple. The hyperbolic metric was just 1 over xn squared dx1 squared. Xn squared. So all the Gij's are zero except the diagonal ones, and all the diagonal ones are equal to this. So if one has a formula for this, if one knows precisely how to calculate this, you just plug in the Gij's, calculate the appropriate derivatives, and get hold of this. Once you have that, once you have the gamma ijk, you can explicitly solve these equations and find out that the only solutions have to be of this type. That's one brute force way of doing it. Other way is to use isometries and so on. First observe that, that if and only if part, I said it's dip. If one is able to prove a given curve has the least length between its endpoints, then it will imply that it's a geodesic as well. So, one can explicitly show that if you take any 2 points here, this one is the curve of the least length. Again, you take any other curve, use this formula for the metric and compare with this. So that will certainly establish that this is a geodesic. Then one observes that there are isometries which would take these 2 points to these 2 points here. In the process, that isometry will deform this line to this circle. An isometry will preserve geodesics. An isometry takes geodesics to geodesics. The moment it preserves the metric, all corresponding quantities are preserved. So geodesics are taken to geodesics. So it would follow that these are geodesics as well. But that would, this process would involve knowing what exactly the isometries of this are. Without that, I mean, you can't. So, if you happen to know isometries of this, you can use that to find geodesics. Or there's a brute force method of calculating the Christoffel symbols and then finding geodesics. And the final example is, of course, this sphere. Ah, that is from uniqueness. See, what you can prove is something more than what I said. So, in other words, you look at this point and a tangent vector. If you can prove that, well, that this is a geodesic, then this will be the unique geodesic, right? Because this prescribed data is given. So, that's it. Yeah. Yeah, no, what I said is that, see, I formulated it in terms of points, right? But I can formulate it slightly differently. I can say that there is an isometry which would take this tangent vector to a given tangent vector and this point to this point. N-dimensional sphere. Yeah, so here geodesics are precisely portions of great circles. Great circle, of course, is a circle which passes through diametrically opposite points. Any portion of a great circle will be a geodesic. Now again, to see this, one has to parameterize the sphere properly, and one can then one will have a nice expression for the. One can use polar coordinates, for instance. And write a sphere as like this. Sphere minus two points can be parameterized like this. So there's a diffeomorphism from here to here. And when I pull back the round metric to this, it has a particularly simple expression. It is just dr squared plus sine r squared times the metric on this. This is the induced round metric on this one. Oh, by the way, this is usually called the round metric. Induced metric is the, for obvious reasons, this is called the round metric. And one has this kind of expression. And, well, of course, that begs the question what this is. But anyway, the point is, if you can start with S2, then proceed step by step. If you start with N equals 2, this will be just the metric on S1. The metric on S1 you can write as, for instance, d theta squared. Even though theta is not well-defined, d theta is a well-defined one form. And you can write it like that and then do the calculation. So in this coordinate system, the Christoffel symbols calculation is easy. And again, you can do this. But there's a more elegant way of doing finding geodesics. Namely, you're right, 0 to pi or minus pi to pi. 0 to pi, otherwise it will vanish two times. Zero, yeah. No, this is correct, 0 to pi. It's, see, sine is 0 here. No, r is not the angle. R is, I'm thinking of r as this radial distance. Where was I? Ah, right. There's a more elegant way of finding geodesics. Namely, it's an observation that if you're able to, if there is a curve in a Riemannian manifold which is fixed by an isometry, fixed in the sense there's a curve such that p of sigma pointwise fixed not as just as a set. If there's a curve which is pointwise fixed, then that curve has to be a geodesic. And suppose phi fixes, then implies sigma is a geodesic. Of course, you might have to change parameterization of that curve. But after suitably parameterizing sigma, it becomes a geodesic. So you can, this, if you're able to find isometries here, which will fix a great circle, then you're in good shape. No, actually not just fix this, the fixed point set, sorry. Sorry. It's a stronger condition. The fixed point set should be precisely this. These are the only fixed points. So phi should fix only this curve and nothing else. And then in that case, one can claim that this is a geodesic. That's a small exercise. And the point is that can be applied in the case of the sphere. You can find reflections which will, if you take any curve, you can find reflections which will fix that. If you take any equatorial circle. Okay. Okay, now the unfortunately, in general, geodesics cannot be defined on the whole interval. So let's talk about that now. We say that a manifold is geodesically complete. This Mahan talked about a bit yesterday. If every geodesic is defined on assuming that, this is somewhat vaguely phrased, but anyway, the point is the length of the maximal interval of definition is infinite. If every geodesic is defined on 0 to infinity. Both ways, yeah. Let me make it on. You can extend it. I started with minus epsilon epsilon, but you can extend it to the whole real line. So this will typically be the case in all the examples you are going to see in this workshop, the symmetric spaces and so on. the only time that this fails is it's like what would constitute an incomplete metric. You can start with something which looks nice enough, but if you remove some points, say R2 minus the origin would not be geodesically complete. Or for that matter, hyperbolic space minus a point and so on. So something being incomplete would in effect mean that there are some points missing from that space. The other situation is nothing is sort of missing. The only missing points are points at which are infinitely far from a given point. That would be something like complete. So keep in mind that the Poincaré, the ball model of hyperbolic space here, the underlying manifold is the open ball. Now it may look as if the boundary points are missing, but the thing to remember is this boundary points, to reach the boundary point from here, I'll end up taking infinite time. It's infinite distance from a given point, any given point here. Infinite distance in the hyperbolic metric, not in the Euclidean metric, of course. So this would be, this is a hyperbolic space is complete. Well, that has to be, that can be seen either from the upper half space model or this model. Here I've not told you what the geodesics are. So that you can probably look it up in the book. I won't have, actually, if I try to say too much, I think I'll run short of some things I'll have to skip. But I think mainly that will be of use. So here's a theorem which relates this notion of, but it's kind of hard to see how to check if a geodesic can be defined on whole of R, mainly because it's defined in terms of a differential equation. And one would like a more workable criteria for checking this. Fortunately, we have this Hoff-Reinau theorem. The infinite extendability of geodesics is directly, it's equivalent to the distance function being a complete distance function. So in other words, Cauchy sequences converge or not. That notion of completeness is equivalent to whether geodesics can be extended infinitely. And either of these imply that any two points in M can be connected by a minimal geodesic. Minimal geodesic is just what I called a length minimizing curve. Same thing. So moment you have a, if you happen to know that it's a complete metric space, then also you have this condition, or if it's geodesically conditioned. But this is, as someone pointed out, this is weaker than this. Yesterday someone pointed out that this condition doesn't imply these two. Even though this actually looks a bit, this looks stronger compared to these two, but this is weaker. The simplest thing is just take the open disk in R2. With the Euclidean metric, not the hyperbolic metric. So this is your manifold with the Euclidean metric. Any two points inside this are connected by a minimal geodesic. But this is not a complete metric space, or is it neither is it geodesically complete? Every geodesic, a straight line, will have to abruptly stop here with the unit speed parameterization. So, yeah. So either of these two will imply connectedness by minimal geodesics, but not the other way around. All right. Finally, let me end with needless to say, I won't have time to give proofs of almost anything from now on. Even just to state all this is taking more time than I expected. So, to make life simple, I'll assume that MG is complete. When I say complete, these two are equivalent. I mean either this or this. So, MG is complete. One doesn't need this condition to define exponential map, but it'll make it a bit easier. So, X from the tangent space to the manifold X at vector V is just gamma V at 1. So, here gamma V is the unique geodesic starting at P with gamma prime 0 equal to V. So, essentially this keeps track of the direction in which this is start. The starting point is always going to be P. This just keeps track of that direction. And then, so what is one doing? Well, one has the tangent space, a vector V. Maybe I should draw it here. This is V. So, this is the point P on the manifold or the origin in the tangent space. So, I just travel along the corresponding geodesic, gamma V in this direction, and then see where I end up at time 1. So, you're just sort of naturally mapping the tangent space to the manifold in some natural way. These straight lines in the tangent space are getting mapped to geodesics here. So, in fact, that's one thing I should mention. So, remark that if I take TV, by definition, this is gamma TV 1, but actually it turns out that this is equal to gamma VT. This is by uniqueness of geodesics. Unique. So one can check that XTV is the same as gamma VT. So TV is a straight line in the tangent space. So I'm looking at the image of the straight line in the tangent space and it's going to the the geodesic itself, gamma VT. So, sort of in radial directions, the map is quite simple. All the action takes place in the transfers to the radial directions. If you look at the spheres in the tangent space, what happens to them is the real content of this map. That's where all the information about curvature and so on is hidden. But we can keep in mind that along radial directions is just quite a simple thing. Now, let me just briefly mention, why is this called the exponential map? It doesn't have anything to do with the exponential. The thing is that if you look at the case of, if M is a compactly grouped, In fact, compact, let me say linear. Actually, compact will imply linear, but let me just add the compact linear Lie group. So in other words, it's a compact subgroup of GL and R, let's say. Such a thing one can show will have a bi-invariant metric. Yesterday I talked a bit about left translation, right translation, and so on. And then I briefly mentioned bi-invariant metric. And then it turns out in that case, this map is literally the exponential of a matrix. So if I start with a compact linear group, the tangent space can also be identified. This is some bunch of matrices here. The tangent space can be identified with a linear subspace of MNR, the group of matrices, the vector space of matrices. And this map turns out to be literally the exponential. Exponential of a matrix. It will land inside the original group. Oh, it has a... All right, so we'll stop here. Next time I'll start with curvature and end by briefly mentioning what a symmetric space is.